are going through an interesting season of transition. Actually, we're preparing right now for our fall, in the fall, I should say now, in the fall, the weather has shifted so dramatically. Holiday season, Christmas season, on into New Year's Eve and New Year's Day, and then whatever the spring is going to bring us. Praise Team will be back joining me live. As a matter of fact, I have to remind you this right now and at the end of service. The Praise Team will be back live with us. And for the service on Thursday morning at 10 a.m., we'll be having a live service right here. Be prepared to call a friend, call a family member, call whoever you need to call, and tell them to come on and join you at church on Thursday morning at 10 a.m. We'll only be in worship about 30, 45 minutes. And then that'll give you an opportunity to go and love on a family member and say Happy Thanksgiving to whoever needs to be said Happy Thanksgiving to. But remember, Thursday morning at 10 a.m. Eastern Standard Time. So adjust your clocks wherever you might be to the time accordingly to whatever it needs to be. And then the following Sunday right after Thanksgiving, remember that is when our annual fall revival concert will air. You do not want to miss the fall revival concert. I promise you, it is absolutely dynamic. But welcome, my brothers and sisters, again to the National Baptist Memorial Church, where we certainly know that the Spirit of the Lord dwells. We're so happy and we're so pleased that you have chosen one more Sunday to join us in worship and fellowship right here. A few things that I want to say and a few announcements that I need to make, but I'll make those a little later. I want to lead you in a prayer right now, if you don't mind. Let us pray. Gracious God, we're so thankful for you each and every day. We're thankful for how you provide for us, how you care for us, and how you usher us into a sacred place with you each and every day. We're thankful for brand new mercies that we see. And we're thankful for the joy in our heart. We're thankful for your peace and your understanding of our frail state, yet you still love us unconditionally. We're thankful, God. We're thankful, God. We're thankful, God, for how much you absolutely wrap us in the cradles of your arm, and that you stabilize us so that we will not be overcome with fear, hurt, doubt, shame, or guilt. We're thankful and we continuously thank you for your grace and for your mercies. We love you, God. We've come to this place together, wherever we might be this morning, to worship you in spirit and in truth. We know for sure, we testify greatly, that wherever the Spirit is, there is liberty. And wherever two or three are gathered, there you are in the midst. And since we are connected even virtually all over everywhere, we say thank you for your sweet, sweet Spirit that is wherever we happen to be at. We praise you. We bless you. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, welcome to you, my brothers and sisters. Whether you happen to be on the streaming app right now, say good morning to your brothers and sisters. Let them know how you are and how you've been. Or whether or not you're on the teleconference this morning, we welcome you as well. So I'm by myself again this morning. We'll be rebroadcasting something else, and I will absolutely be tuned in with the Praise Team. They're also tuned in as well, and they're watching from wherever they happen to be right now. And they're getting things together and getting things situated, just like I said, from before. But look, they're all here with you, and we're all ready for you. We're going to broadcast the service accordingly. And we'll never, you know, just leave you out there hanging by yourself. This is another interesting moment that I need to say, an announcement that I need to make. We're changing platforms. As Kieran and I discussed some things this morning about some platforms that might need to be adjusted and changed as we are broadcasting out. And Kieran suggested some actions and some activities that we can do and some ways that we can actually bring you, our family and friends, there to wherever you happen to be streaming, wherever you happen to be, into the worship more directly. So if you are curious about maybe being a greeter for us virtually, or welcoming folk in virtually, you just have that charisma, and you just have that desire, even that will, that passion to serve the Lord, even serve the Lord from your house, we are interested to hear from you and to know what you think about and how you feel about maybe becoming part of our virtual broadcast. It appears that we're going to be in this space a little longer, and we're okay with that. And we're preparing to make sure that you, my brothers and sisters, my family and friends, my church members, those of you that have joined since we've been streaming through this app, that if you want to join in that process, you got one of those speaking voices, or you have one of those beautiful smiling faces, or you just got a zeal and a zest to be a virtual usher, we're going to figure out how to bring you on board. Think about it. Send me a message and let me know if you are interested, and we will figure out a way to get you engaged and get you involved. All right. So I want you to call a friend right now. Let them know, come on to church with me this morning. You're going to enjoy this message coming from the Gospel of John, where Jesus and Nicodemus are having a conversation with each other. Stick around, and I'll be back in a few brief moments.
For those of you that are just joining us, we welcome you into worship with us this morning. Glad that you took out the opportunity to come on in here, fellowship with us. Put a smile on your face, square your shoulders, sit up straight, focus, zoom in, and get yourself, your mind, your heart, and your spirit ready to celebrate and worship with us in spirit and in truth. Amen. Amen. My brothers and sisters, allow me some time right now to read to you our scriptural lesson for the morning. It's found in the book of 2 Peter, all the way in the back of the New Testament. 2 Peter chapter 3, starting at verse 8. And it says, "But you must not forget this one thing, dear friends. A day is like 1,000 years to the Lord, and 1,000 years is like a day. The Lord really isn't being slow about his promise, as some people think. No, he is being patient for your sake. He does not want anyone to be destroyed, but wants everyone to repent. But the day of the Lord will come unexpectedly as a thief, and then the heavens will pass away with a terrible noise. And the very elements themselves will disappear in fire. And the earth and everything on it will be found to deserve judgment. Since then, everything around us is going to be destroyed like this. What holy and godly lives you should live, looking forward to the day of God and hurrying it along. On that day, he will set the heavens on fire and the elements will melt away in the flame. But we, let me say this, but we are looking forward to the new heavens and the new earth he has promised, a world filled with God's righteousness." This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. I am going to get out the way. Flo's coming. I can't tell which side you're on. I think you're over there. Flo is coming up. She's going to give us our real and relevant moment. I need her to go ahead and do that now so she can reserve her voice, because I feel like she's got something to sing about this morning. Amen. And after Flo gives us the real and relevant moment, I'm going to come back and welcome our guests and visitors with you this morning. Amen.
All right. Good morning, beautiful people. So today we're going to talk about allowing God to pull you out of your comfort zone. This morning, this is brand new to me, and a lot of times when God is trying to move you out of your comfort zone to receive the blessings he has for you, it is a struggle. It can be very painful. It could be frustrating. But with that, the reward in that is just following him, trusting him, breaking away from things that are normal or things that you lack in, and just trusting him that he will bring you to where he wants you to be. So that's my relevant moment for this morning for you all. Short and sweet.
Flo tricked me. She got up here like she was about to deliver a sermon. She threw a Baptist prayer up here in 10 minutes and ran back to her position. Amen. We're thankful for these real relevant moments. I know that each of you have a real and relevant moment, a testimony, if you will, to talk about how good God has been and how God has blessed you in the midst of. So while we're riding in this storm, we're riding on this boat together, we're riding in this ship together, don't be like Jonah and cause us to get all rocky and shaky and have to be thrown overboard, because I will throw you. But why don't you stay in the boat with the family? Let us stay praying together, stay connected with each other, loving one another. And since I'm there, to my guests and visitors that are joining us this morning, we want you to know that this sweet, sweet spirit that you feel coming through, it's always with us. We can't wait until the doors of the church swing back open. Let me say this. the building on the doors of the church swing back open. The church is still open. The building is closed. But we're still available. And we're still ready to receive you and pray for you and celebrate with you and worship with you and encourage you. We're still here for you. My brothers and sisters, we welcome you. All guests and visitors, if you've just joined in, if this is the first time you joined, if you're a repeat visitor, even online, we welcome you. We welcome you. Now, praise team is about to give us one verse of Sweet, Sweet Spirit. They're trying to get their minds together because Micah just threw them off playing through the storm.
Thank you.
I appreciate that. I don't know if I need to be disconnected to how they're thinking now.
Probably
don't. We're all here right now. But we appreciate you. And we want to welcome you in this space. I'm going to step out and they're going to let you know. There's a sweet, sweet spirit. Schedule is Monday and Thursday, and we're doing a whole lot of other pop-ups throughout the week, so stay connected to the website so that you can see an update of those dates, because just like that, we get a call from Capital Food Bank, and we open up the doors, step out there, and begin to pass out meals. But absolutely, Mondays and Thursdays between 11 and 2:30, just bring a kid with you, bring multiple children with you. And each one gets at least 3 meals. And we're happy about that. We will continue that throughout the entire summer up until the point that schools are back in and children that may have otherwise not received a meal throughout the day can come back into one of our public school spaces. So keep that in mind. Keep on watching the website. Matter of fact, all of you all that are out there, keep on donating to this ministry so that we're able to make sure that we're feeding those that are in need. Those are that need, feeding those that need. We have to feed them before they can hear.
That's right.
You can't do nothing if your stomach is hungry. You got to feed them so that they can hear. And so we are loving on them. We're caring for them, in particular the children. So as long as you bring them all, come on over there and grab you something. Amen. Also, as I'm saying that, as a standard, every second and fourth Saturday of the month, we have our normal still food distribution. So you all come on in and come on in and keep on coming on. I'm getting out of the way now. We're already at the point of the sermon. I guess I'm up. And so the praise team is going to give us a word. Then I'll be back in a few minutes. See you in a second. many of you have been there? When the storms of life seem to rage, waves are bigger than your life can take. When the sea water is drowning you, and you feel like you're on your last breath, one more teaspoon would certainly drown you. You ever been there before? When you were just grabbing for air, you were grabbing for land, you were grabbing for something. And in the midst of it, sweet, sweet spirit blew you away as you were grabbing. You realized that all you needed to do was raise up your hand. Say, Father, I stretch my hands to thee. No other help I know. If thou withdraw from me, well, Lord, where will I go? But then you open up your mouth and then you begin to declare. You make a sure declaration that whatever my lot, whatever it might be, thank you, Jesus, it is well. Whatever I might go through, season and out of season, because of you, it is well. It is well. It is well. Come on, Tashira.
It is well. It is
something, get you one. What we know for sure is that this word never fails. As a matter of fact, I haven't done this in a while, and I just want to let you all know that if you're out there, if you've tuned in with us this morning and you don't have a Bible, you don't own a Bible, you can't even afford a Bible, just send a message in there and let me know. Let me know how to get in contact with you. We'll certainly get a Bible out to you, get one in your hand so that when you are joining us, that sometimes the cell phones and the apps fail, but these pages, they still flip and they continue to go. Amen? But let us know if you're in need. We're here to help you, to assist you. I want to read to you this morning from the Gospel according to John chapter 3. The Gospel of John chapter 3. I'm going to be reading from the New Living Translation of the Bible this morning, John chapter 3. When you get there, whatever translation you're reading out of, words that you'll find starting at verse 1. There was a man named Nicodemus, all know that God has sent you to teach us. Your miraculous signs are evidence that God is with you. Jesus replied, I tell you the truth, unless you are born again, you cannot see the kingdom of God. What do you mean? Exclaimed Nicodemus. How can an old man go back into his mother's womb and be born again? Jesus replied, I assure you, no one can enter the kingdom of God without being born of water and the Spirit. Humans can reproduce only human life, but the Holy Spirit gives birth to spiritual life. So don't be surprised when I say to you, Nicodemus, you must be born again. The wind blows wherever it wants, just as you can hear the wind but can't tell where it comes from. Where it is going. So you can't explain how people are born of the Spirit. How are these things possible? Nicodemus asked. Jesus replied, you are a respected Jewish teacher, and yet you don't understand these things. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. The grass withers and the flowers fade. When the breath of the Lord blows upon it, surely the people are the grass. The grass withers and the flowers fade, but the word of the Lord stands forever. Holy Spirit, have you. Holy Spirit, make a way. Holy Spirit, be in this place with us on this day. Move us from a state of simply listening to a place and a reality of hearing. For we know that faith cometh by hearing, and that hearing by the word of God. So Holy Spirit, blow this way. Open up our hearts, open up our minds, open up our eyes, open up our ears, that we might receive a word from you. Be our guide and our teachers, in Christ's name that we pray. Amen. Since the beginning of this pandemic, my brothers and sisters, we have had at National Baptist, we've had Bible study via Zoom meeting every Wednesday night at 7:30. It has been one of my favorite times of the week because I have an opportunity to be very intentional and direct with each person attending. Just about any topic imaginable is studied and discussed during an hour or so that we are together. And because of that, many weeks I come into the lesson holding my breath, but still trusting that God has sent me at the right time and the right place with the right message to deliver a word and share something with God's people. You can learn a lot. You can learn a whole lot about people when you choose to sit down and you choose to open up the dialogue and then study with them. And the many things that I have learned from this group is that they come to the table with open hearts and honest answers. But there's one thing that I have really learned from studying with this community of faith, and that is that we can't afford to assume that people understand what you mean just because you say you think what you mean. Let me say that another way. Just because you understand what you are talking about, just because you understand the background and the history of the words that you are using, just because it makes sense in your head, it does not mean that everybody else will understand what you are talking about. Have you ever been talking to somebody and they are doing their best to make a point? And as a matter of fact, they keep talking and they keep on trying to convince you, or you're getting in their way of convincing you of something, or they're trying to get you to get to that point to understand what they are really saying. And right before you give up and walk away, you ask them to give you an example of what they mean, and they end up confused talking about. That's where we find ourselves in this story this morning, right at the point with Nicodemus asking Jesus, what are you talking about? I browsed through some journals and some articles over this past week, and I browsed and read an article written by Mary Fairchild where she discusses how Christians often miss the mark by talking over, under, and around people. She seemed to suggest, you all, that if you are in the Christian club, then you get indoctrinated with a cheat sheet of phrases, statements, and call and responses that you adapt to, and then you begin to spread them. And often for people that are not Christian, those statements are lost in translation. She writes, it may be painful to admit that we use Christian cliche sayings and phrases, but the first step of getting help is admitting that we have a problem at all. I mean, I have to admit, I'm guilty. I'm guilty of using the Christian cliches. Of course I am, right? I'm a preacher. I mean, we often and we so often use them all day to express what we assume the community needs to hear. But sometimes these phrases might not be helpful, especially if the person on the receiving end does not know what you are talking about. Listen, there was a Christian host on the radio station, and he was interviewing a young woman. She was a brand new believer, and the joy that she felt was bubbling up in her, and you could tell that it was bubbling up in her because you can hear it in her voice as she talked about this change that had come over her life. She was experiencing God and enjoying this new experience and enjoying this new relationship with Him that she had never enjoyed ever in her life. But much like a stranger that was sojourning through a foreign land, she struggled to find the right words. She struggled to find the appropriate words to express what she was feeling in her heart, the joy and the excitement and the anticipation that she was going through. She struggled to put words to it and spit it out. The DJ asked her, so you were born again, huh? And she was hesitant as she answered, that didn't satisfy the DJ, hoping to hear something more confident, something more demonstrative. The DJ pressed her a little further. You received Jesus, right? Jesus did come into your life. You have been saved, right? There was no doubt, my brothers and sisters, that she was overflowing with the joy of Jesus in her heart. But the DJ's questions, his insistence on proper phraseology, were weighing down on her joy. Her reliance, or his reliance on these cliches that we use, these terms that we use, could have made her begin to doubt this salvation that she was so excited about. And just like the DJ in this story, we Christians are guilty of sin of cliche abuse. Cliche abuse, you say, Pastor. What do you mean by that? Think about it. Christians say, I asked Jesus into my heart, or I was born again, or I was saved, or we can just assume that they probably were not. Christians don't say hello. We greet one another with a hug and a holy kiss. To a complete stranger just passing us by, walking down the street, a good Christian won't hesitate to announce, Jesus loves you, and so do I, with an outstretched hand. Whether affectionately or with pity, Christians often say, bless your heart. I know y'all know that one all too well, because you got to slow it down and put on a good southern drawl. You got to turn your head, bless your heart. You gotta look real sick. I know it's in your head right now because you can see it and you can hear yourself saying it, from grins or even groans. We throw in that old familiar one. God works in mysterious ways. And that ain't nowhere in the Bible. But when the pastor preaches a powerful message and the choir is singing that morning, Christians yell out and they exclaim at the close of the service, we had church today. preached a powerful message, no Christians say the pastor was oily this morning. Now, Christians don't have good days. We get the victory. And a great day is a mountaintop experience. Can I get an amen? Can I get a witness? Christians don't have bad days either. No, we're under the attack of the enemy. Christians don't ever say, have a good day. We say, have a blessed day. Christians don't have parties. We have fellowships. Christians don't get depressed. We have a spirit of heaviness. An enthusiastic Christian is on fire for the Lord. Christians don't gossip. We share prayer requests. Christians don't tell stories. We give testimonies or praise reports. Y'all with me? When a Christian does not know how to respond to someone who is hurting, we utter, well, I'll be praying for you. And after that comes, God is in control. And next we say, all things work together for the good. Should I keep on going? If God closes one door, he'll open a window. Christians don't make decisions. We are led by the Spirit. As a matter of fact, Christians RSVP with phrases such as, I'll be there if it's God's will, or Lord willing, and the creek don't rise. When a Christian makes a mistake, we say, charge it to my head and not my heart. Christians don't insult or say rude things to a brother or sister in Christ. No, we speak truth in love and power. And if a Christian meets someone who is stressed or anxious, we know they simply need to just let go and let God. Last but not least, Christians don't die. No. We just go home to be with the Lord. The problem with all of these messages is that they are somehow uniquely Christian. They are terms and phrases that are significant and impactful for a group of people who code switch in and out of church speak. And this is why I appreciate this Bible study so much. If you haven't recognized, I'm pushing and encouraging Bible study. This is why I appreciate our Bible study so much. They have shown me that we don't necessarily live in an era of churched people. More often than not, especially now, we encounter generations, not just this current generations, but many generations of people who had options. Did y'all know they had the option not to go to church? They had the option not to practice any designated faith practice. They had the option not to go to vacation Bible school. They had the option not to get baptized, not to sing in the children's choir, not to read the Bible, and not to have to declare themselves. They did not learn to speak the church's language. So now when we Christian folks, when we interact with them, when we use church language on an unchurched generation, they have no idea what we are talking about. Come on, Nicodemus. How many of you have ever found yourself trying to evangelize and tell somebody about Jesus and you are met with the response like, I ain't trying to hear none of that? 9 times out of 10, the problem is that you were trying to draw somebody to Jesus using language that you did not understand. And they definitely don't understand. Let me prove it. If you think back to the last time that something like this happened to you, you'll realize that your Christian cliche default button was turned on. And instead of figuring out what you could do or say to present the case from Jesus, y'all remember Paul, don't you? I became some things to all men that some might be saved. Not all, but some might be saved. And instead of figuring out what you could do or say to present the case for Jesus, you most likely responded in a passive-aggressive way with a head nod or two, and then out of your mouth popped out, the Bible says, forsake not the assembly, and I'll keep you in prayer. John's gospel allows us to witness the intimate connectivity and the intimacy of conversations between Jesus and certain people. Listen, more important, you get to hear and you and I get to feel the impact of answers that Jesus gives to the people that he is interacting with. We could say that the biblical base of this story, the biblical base of the narrative, is found in John 1 and 1, where it reads, "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was with God. He was in the beginning with God. All things were made through him, and without him nothing was made. That was made in him was life, and the life was the light of men. And the light shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not comprehend it." And it ends somewhere around John 3:16, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever shall believe in him shall have everlasting life." John describes Nicodemus as a Pharisee. Sad to say, Pharisees are in many ways the victims of bad press. In our modern terminology, some of them were victims of fake news. They were not all bad. They were not all uptight. They were not all holier than thou. The Pharisees were people who sincerely desired to lead lives that were pleasing to God. They were consistent with his laws laid down in the Old Testament. They were moral, upright. They were regular attendees in the synagogues. They were tithers. And in every respect, they were model citizens. These were just the kind of people that you and I would want to have as your neighbors. Most biblical scholars confirm that Nicodemus, the Pharisee, belonged to the Jewish council called the Sanhedrin. The Sanhedrin was the religious sect that maintained God was not the God of the dead, but God was the God of the living. And after life on earth, those who believed in God of Israel enjoyed a better life beyond the grave. And so it's safe for us to assume that Nicodemus subscribed to that same teaching. This group of people held on to the highest legal, judicial, and legislative authority among the laws. In other words, they acted like the president, the Congress, and the Supreme Court, all wrapped in one. So then John, recordings of Nicodemus' meeting, was one of a number of prominent and influential people who came to Jesus in the Gospels. Among them were a centurion, a royal official, Lazarus of Bethany, the anonymous rich young ruler, Jairus, the synagogue ruler, Zacchaeus, the tax collector, and Simon the Pharisee. And we are given the account of then an intimate encounter between this religious man, this teacher, concerned about his soul's salvation, and the one whom salvation comes from. John wants the reader to know that although Nicodemus sat quite close to the giver of life, Nicodemus' understanding of how God's gift of life is received remained far, far distant and even absent from him. John's recorded encounter between Jesus and Nicodemus was a big deal, y'all. John further informs us that Nicodemus was not only a Pharisee, but he was a religious leader. Nicodemus was not just an average Pharisee. Jesus considered Nicodemus to be the Pharisee's most prominent and illustrious scholar, asking him, "Aren't you the teacher of Israel?" And not just, "Aren't you a teacher?" but "Aren't you the teacher of Israel?" And according to John, Nicodemus begins then his dialogue with Jesus by confessing his acknowledgement of the miracles of Jesus and admitting that they could only come from God. Nicodemus had no problem admitting that God had to be in it. So the question regarding the source from which Jesus' ministry came was not the issue. Here's the issue. Nicodemus is trying to figure out whether or not the law and the prophecies were finally being fulfilled in the person of Jesus. Nicodemus is trying to figure out if Jesus is who they say he is. Now let me parenthetically pause and parallel park really quick and tell somebody out there about they. Y'all know who they is, don't you? You know who they are. The dictionary says that they is an unseen character in theater, comics, film, or television, or a silent character or a person that is mentioned but not directly known to the audience, but who advances the action of the plot in a significant way, and whose absence enhances the effects on the plot. What did you just say, preacher? Well, I'm glad you asked. They, my brothers and sisters, whoever they are, is a messy person, instigating foolishness and causing problems. And usually the messy person that is talking to you and telling you what they said is actually they. They have been saying and doing things since the beginning of time. They have been talking about you. They have been judging you. They have been critical of you. They have been spreading your business and jeopardizing your future. And after all that they have to say, they never step up and declare it or say it for themselves. But I'm glad about Jesus, that even when approached under the cloak of night, he ain't nothing like they are. I'm glad that when we are hungry, Jesus is still declaring, I am the bread of life. I'm glad that when things seem dim in your life, Jesus is still declaring, I am the light of the world. I'm so glad that when we are in a need of a way in and even a way out, Jesus is declaring, I am the door. I'm so glad that when you are in the valley and when I am in the shadows of death, Jesus is still declaring, I am the good shepherd. I am glad that when they get up and when they walk away and they despise you and they leave me, Jesus is declaring, I am the vine. Not only that, but I'm glad that when I'm not sure about this life's journey and everything around me feels like sinking sand, Jesus declares, I am the way, the truth, and the light. And when I find myself crying out in the middle of the night like Nicodemus, Jesus declares, I am the resurrection and the life. As long as Jesus is declaring, nothing that they say will ever even matter. He knew, Nicodemus knew, what had been prophesied about the coming of the Messiah. I'm sure he had heard unlimited accounts of the new teacher who shut it down in the pulpits at the revival, healed the leper in the back of the church by the food pantry, and restored the politically oppressed to their rightful place in society, since everybody in the hood was saying that Jesus was the one. Nicodemus wanted to know for himself, could this be true? Is Jesus the one? And if not, then who? Well, allow me for a few more minutes to sketch out the plot and the issues at hand. The Bible says that Nicodemus came by night. He is so caught up in what others might think and what others might say that he only comes to Jesus when nobody is looking. John tells us that Nicodemus came to Jesus by night. Now, night and darkness are significant themes and significant words for John and in John's gospel. For example, in the opening chapter, John has told us of Jesus, the eternal word, the light that shines in darkness, and darkness did not overcome it. Jesus proclaims of himself, I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will never walk in darkness, but will have light of life. It was still dark on the first Easter morning that Mary Magdalene, believing Jesus to be dead, went to the tomb. And perhaps most significantly of all, after Judas leaves the Passover supper in the upper room, John randomly writes, and it was night. So it was significant for John to report that Nicodemus came to Jesus by night. And so we need to ask ourselves, why? Why is that so important? It may be easily, or it could have been easy, because the crowds would have dispersed away from Jesus by this time. Things would definitely have been quieter about this time, and he could have had his own audience without having to be disturbed or interrupt somebody else's deep conversations. It has been my experience that some of the most significant conversations in my life have taken place at night. Anybody else ever had some deep conversations in the middle of the night? I can testify that sometimes when the phone rings late at night, you might need to answer. You don't always need to answer, but you might need to answer. Some of those conversations have resolved fights and arguments. Some of those conversations have ended long-standing issues. Some of those conversations have helped me rest. Anybody know what I'm talking about? But how many of you can testify that sometimes in the midnight hour when everybody is gone and fast asleep and everything is silent all around you, that just a little talk with Jesus, just a little talk with Jesus will make it all right? How many of you can testify to talking to Jesus all night long? How many of you can testify to know what it's like to fall on your knees and cry out to him? How many of you know what Nicodemus must have been feeling when he needed to find Jesus in the middle of the night? Do you know? Have you been there? You got some issues. You got some questions. You got some pain. You've received a bad report and can't nobody answer except Jesus. How many of you know what Nicodemus was going through? Nicodemus came to Jesus by night, and it seems that he did not wish to be seen by anybody as he approached. He is mentioned three times in the gospel, but on this night, he came by night. The other time in chapter 7, knowing that there were plots to kill, Jesus has gone to Jerusalem secretly, not even telling his brothers that he was gone. And midway through the festival, he begins to teach in the temple. Inevitably, there is some controversy over him, but the temple police hold back from arresting him. And when the Pharisees criticize the police for their inaction, it is Nicodemus who stands up and asks, "Our law does not judge people without first giving them a hearing to find out what they are doing, does it?" And for that reason, that situation, that matter seemed to be put to rest. But this same man, Nicodemus, is also recorded toward the end of the gospel message. Jesus has died on the cross, and Joseph of Arimathea has petitioned Pontius Pilate for his body. And John tells us that Nicodemus, who had at first come to Jesus by night, also came bringing a mixture of myrrh and aloes, weighing about 100 pounds. I think it is significant that John chooses to identify Nicodemus as the one who came to Jesus by night under the cloak of darkness. It seems to me that while Nicodemus had sympathy for Jesus, he always stood on the sidelines and in the shadows. He never quite was willing to come out and stand on his own two feet. We could parallel Nicodemus to Peter. Y'all remember Peter, don't you? He even denies knowing Jesus three times. But the Bible says this same Peter, Jesus declares, "On this rock I will build my church." This same Peter that calls from the boat, "Master, is that you out there?" This same Peter that declares the devil wants you, and Jesus tells him, "Peter, the devil wants you to sift you as wheat, but I am praying for you, Peter." He is reconciled. He is filled with the Holy Ghost, and he later answers the high priest and even the council of the Sanhedrin by saying, "Whether it is in God's sight to listen to you rather than in God's, you got to be the judge about that. Whether it is right for me to listen to my God and then listen to you, you must judge, for we cannot keep from speaking about what we have seen and even what we have heard." Nicodemus was on that Sanhedrin council and was probably there when Peter spoke, yet we never hear from him again. He simply falls back and slips into the shadows, never willing to come out and stand for himself. There ain't nothing or nobody, y'all, that's powerful enough to cause you to withhold your testimony or your praise. God has been significantly and impactfully too good to each and every one of us. And not only that, he's been better than even that. And when I think of the goodness of Jesus, that's why my soul can cry out, "Hallelujah," because God has been so, so, so good. The tragedy is that down through the years, there have been too many Nicodemuses, men and women who respect Jesus, who admire him, yet whether it is for fear or for some other reason, They find themselves unable to step out and testify about him. But we let everybody else testify about the goodness of everything else. But we stay silent about the goodness of Jesus. That's why I am so confused and so shocked when I see so many preachers and religious teachers swarming around the current tenant in the White House. I am surprised that the White House's tenant could be in the presence of a room full of people claiming to carry the power of the Holy Ghost, and even in the midst of all of that, he is still only able to praise and lie about his accomplishments. We have to wait to see and bear witness to the foolishness of his conversations with them when Zacchaeus and Zacchaeus couldn't wait another minute after meeting Jesus to get it right. And just from being in his presence, Zacchaeus repented for the ways he mistreated people. Don't ever let anybody or anything steal your witness. So John writes, this is the judgment, that the light has come into the world, and people love darkness rather than the light. Here it is. Nicodemus believed that a person only lived one life, and that life had to be well lived if you were to hope to enter into God's kingdom. Jesus calls into question then Nicodemus' thinking and his way of life. According to Jesus, Nicodemus would need to be baptized into new life to gain access to the kingdom. You needed to experience a regeneration of your spirit and your soul before you could benefit from the change of heart. And grasping the true nature then of Nicodemus's visit, Jesus puts Nicodemus out of his misery by dropping a theological bombshell. Jesus tells Nicodemus he knows what Nicodemus is looking for, but he won't be able to find it unless he is born from above. Jesus argues, unless a person be born again, you will not be able to see the kingdom of God or how the Messiah reigns in it. So it is under the shadows and with no one around that Nicodemus begins by expressing his admiration for Jesus. Rabbi, we know that you are a teacher who has come from God, because can't nobody else do those things that you did, and can't nobody do them, period, if it did not come from him. Jesus then responds, and his response puzzles Nicodemus. Very truly, I tell you, no one can see the kingdom of God without being born again. Jesus' words literally, amen, amen, I say to you, amen, amen, I say to you, no one can see the kingdom. What is it that prompted these words? The answer is found in the way that John introduces Nicodemus in the very first verse. Literally, it goes, now there was a Pharisee named Nicodemus. But this is an odd turn of phrase in the Greek language. And John has chosen to use it specifically because of what he has just finished saying in the previous passage of Scripture, which is, if you read it literally, Jesus did not need anyone to testify about man, for he knew already what was in man's heart. And then it continues, there was a man named Nicodemus. What I can only conclude is that Jesus knew exactly what was going on in Nicodemus' heart. And he chose to speak not to his words, but directly to his heart. Remember that Nicodemus was a Pharisee. His whole life was dedicated to the obedience of the law. What Jesus was saying was, Nicodemus, you have spent your whole life, your entire life, doing things for God. And tragically, you have missed the point. It's not about what you can do for me, but it's about what I can do in you. To see how focused Nicodemus was on doing things, you only need to look at how he responds in confusion. Can an old man enter into his mother's womb and be born? His response was all about what he could do in himself, his efforts, his handiwork, his endeavor. And so Jesus drives the point home again. He says, listen, Nicodemus, while I tell you another time, no one can enter the kingdom of God without being born of water and of spirit. Jesus makes the same point again when he shifts from the mystery of birth to the mystery of when. You hear the sound of it, but you don't know where it comes from or where it is going. In Hebrew and the spirit. No one can control the wind. God reminds Job of this by asking, where were you when I laid the foundations of the earth? Tell me if you understand. Who marked off its dimensions? Surely you know. Who stretched the measure line across it? On what were its footings set? Or who laid its cornerstones? While the morning stars sang together and the angels shouted for joy, who shut up the sea behind the doors when it burst forth from the womb? When I made the clouds its garment and wrapped it in thick darkness, when I fixed limits for it and set its doors and bars in place, when I said, this far you may come no further, here is where your proud waves halt. Have you entered the storehouse of snow or seen the storehouses of hail, which I reserve for times of trouble, for days of war and battle? What is the way to the place where the lightning is dispersed, or the place where the east winds are scattered over the earth? The same understanding was true of those brothers on the boat with Jesus that simply declared, what manner of man is this, that even the winds and the seas, they obey? God's movements, my brothers and sisters, God's movement is fluid and unpredictable. We cannot control God. We cannot box God in. Being born again is an act of God's grace that cannot be contained or controlled by earthly wisdom or earthly means. By virtue of Nicodemus as being the teacher and not just a teacher, Jesus asked Nicodemus, why haven't you figured this out by now? Jesus was inviting Nicodemus to allow the Holy Ghost, the Holy Spirit, to blow in his life, to allow the Spirit to do in him, even with the strictest obedience, even with the best efforts, what he could not do in himself. And that's why later on, down the road in the New Testament, we meet another Pharisee named Saul, who was changed and transitioned to Paul. And he declared, if anyone else has reason to be confident in the flesh, I have more circumcised, only 8 days, a member of the people of Israel, of the tribe of Benjamin, a Hebrew born of Hebrews. And as to the law, a Pharisee, a zeal, prosecutor of the church. As to righteousness under the law, blameless. Yet whatever gains I had, these I have come to regard as a loss because of Christ. More than that, I regard everything as loss because of the surpassing value of knowing Christ Jesus as my Lord. Pastor Matthew Wiley told a story. He said one of his favorite television shows as a child was The $6 Million Man. The show was about an astronaut pilot named Steve Austin. Austin was once in a terrible accident that messed him up pretty bad. As a consequence, he was wheeled into a top secret operating room. And the room was filled with surgeons and nurses who scurried and stabilized him. In the midst of all of the chaos and drama, a loud voice said, we can rebuild him. The doctors are then seen attaching limbs to his body that are not his original limbs. And the limbs were specifically constructed bionic limbs. And at the end of the surgery, Austin appears and he looks like an average person. But in reality, he's not average because his new body enables him to do stuff that others can't do. I love that story because when Austin was at his lowest point in life, a group of doctors decided they not only could rebuild him, but they could make him better. And that's good news to me, despite all the things that we're going through in life. I'm glad to know that every time I enter the Holy Ghost operating room, the Godhead, God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Ghost looks at me and says, we can rebuild him. We can make him new all over again. Jesus' conversation with Nicodemus occupies a very special place in my own life. When Jesus spoke to Nicodemus, it was as though he were speaking directly to me. In very truth, I tell you, no one can enter the kingdom without being born again. Those words should cause us to bow down, confess with our hearts, and declare with our mouths that Jesus is Lord. Frederick the Great, Persian king, died. His death ignited a large funeral procession. People lined up along the streets to pay homage to their great leader's homegoing. And as the king's casket passed on to the top in his on the top of his casket, this mongoloid, this mutt dog. And the sight of the ugly dog caused much uproar and rebuttal from the onlookers and the people known for breeding great dogs such as German Shepherd and the Doberman Pinscher. But this dog was not one of their fine dogs. And suddenly some onlooker dashed to the casket to remove the dog. But he found an attractive metal collar around the dog's neck that simply read, "It found return to the king." Word spread quickly. The ugly dog was all right because he belonged to the king. And that's all that I came to say this morning, my brothers and sisters. It doesn't matter how ugly your past. If you have been redeemed by Jesus Christ, the word will go out that believer is all right because he belongs to the king. I'm finished, but let me share this with you. Nicodemus never came out of the shadows. But thank God that you and I have an opportunity to let him do some work in each and every one of us. To allow us to minister to a place and a space where we are not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Where we can testify myself. I am the witness. I am the proof. How am I the proof? Because I woke up this morning. How am I the proof? Because he started me on my way. How am I the proof? Because he who has begun a good work in me is working through me to complete it. How am I the proof? Even with a cliche, all things work and all things are working together right now for our good. How am I the proof? I was once young, but now I'm old. And I've never been forsaken. How are you the proof?
My brothers and sisters, it's a powerful message and a question that each of us have to ask ourselves. How do you know that you have proof, that you have evidence that Jesus is the Christ? I invite you right now, all that had an ear to hear and an open heart to receive, all of you, my brothers and sisters out there, if that is you today and you can testify to that goodness, that you can step out of the shadows, move away from Nicodemus's situation and step out of the darkness, but come into the precious and beautiful light. If that's you today, and you know for yourself, you are absolutely sure, you are positive that you need to come on forward and you need to give the Lord your hand today and you need to repent and just let it go and trust in the Lord. If that is you today, my brothers and sisters, I offer Christ to you today. Why don't you say this simple prayer with me? Lord God, I am a sinner. I'm a wretch and often a mess. But you've showed me favor, you showed me grace, and you showed me love in spite of. I confess my sins. I ask that you clean me up and make me new. I confess, I believe, and I know that Jesus is the Son of the living God. He suffered, bled, and died for my sins. He is seated at the right hand of the Father. And he has all power in his hand. His kingdom has no ending, and he will come back for me again. I believe that I'm redeemed by the blood of the Lamb, and I'm healed from the oppression of sin. If you've said that simple prayer with me this morning, my brother, my sister, I am sure, I am positive that you have been redeemed by the blood of the Lamb, and I celebrate you, and I celebrate with you, and I'm going to be praying for you just as everyone else in this church family and community will be praying for you. Look, if you are at a distant place in life, and in actually a physically distant place, and you don't have a Bible-based believing and teaching a community of faith that can surround you, why don't you contact me and allow me an opportunity to connect you with one near you? But until then, stay connected here. Stay connected here so that we can keep you surrounded and pray for you. Forsake not the assembly. This is not the time, it is not the place, it is not the season for you to run back. Accept Jesus and let all the other stuff go. Now, as we're transitioning in this blessed day, and we're being grateful and thankful for all things, it is also now time for us to continue to worship the Lord in spirit and in truth in our giving. Mentioned in the sermon, and even in that week, and I'll say it again today, we are still actively every day in season and out of season feeding the disadvantaged and those that are in need and those that are vulnerable and in a vulnerable food crisis in our community in the Columbia Heights neighborhood of Washington, D.C. And we would very much appreciate your support as we continue to minister and to give. And so in that vein, consider donating to our food pantry and even our clothes closet. And on top of that, my brothers and sisters, this is giving time. It is giving time right now. Those of you that are streaming with us right now, you can give right there on the website. Just click the donate tab and give. Give generously. Give with a cheerful heart and a smile on your face. For those of you that are in the neighborhood, you can stop on by the church and just drop your offering off. For those of you that are at a distance, you can even just mail in your offering to National Baptist Memorial Church, 1501 Columbia Road, Northwest Washington, D.C., 2009. Amen. So why don't you grab the best gift that you have right now, even if you don't have a gift to give today, but you have a desire to, just raise your hand and raise your gift in your hand with us. Let us pray. Gracious God, we're so thankful for you each and every day. We're thankful for how you bless us over and over again. We recognize that we can't beat your giving no matter how hard we try. And so we give back a little bit to you, God. A little bit of just what you've given us to sustain us and fortify us. The provisions that you pour down in us, now we freely give back to you. And we know and we believe that you will bless them indeed. Cause them to be pressed down, shaken together, and runneth over in every area of our lives. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. I'm believing that for each and every one of you that God will do exceedingly and abundantly above all that you can ask, think, or imagine. Amen. So just a few quick announcements and a few messages. I want to wish a happy birthday to my favorite uncle. I mentioned him in the sermon. Here's my old Bible. I told you all my old favorite Bible that he gave me when I was leaving Chicago many years ago. And it still has just as many, probably more pieces of paper and sticky notes and everything that it could possibly be in there. I flipped it open the other day and realized that I have these little tabs that are in here. That when I was studying for ordination, going through catechism, I used this Bible to study with, and I would mark with these little tabs of the different categories of things that we would be studying. This is my Bible that I carry with me each and every day. And I would tell you, get you one as well. I said it in that sermon and hit me again. And I had a few folk hit us up to say that we need a Bible, but trust me and listen to me, hear me. If you don't have a Bible of your own, send me a message and we'll make sure to get one out to you in this season. In this season of Thanksgiving, my brothers and sisters, where we probably have a lot of mixed emotions about what's going on and not quite sure what we have to be thankful for. I want to remind you and I want to extend this fellowship to you. We have so much to be thankful for because so many of us have a testimony of going through the valley and the shadow of death in this year, 2020, and going through so much trauma and trial and tribulation. But I want to say this to you. not to be cliche-ish, but to really, really impart this on you. You are still here, and that means that God is not done with you yet. And if for no other reason that you have something to be grateful for, you are still here. And guess what? When you open up your eyes this morning to the dawning of a new day, brand new mercies, and I'm so excited about the mercies of God and the favor of God on each and every one of your lives, I want you to remember to check back to the website regularly, but keep this in your forefront right now, your forethought. No Bible study this Wednesday, but Thursday morning at 10 a.m. Eastern Standard Time, guess what? I'll be right back here, and we're going to have a worship opportunity to give God thanks on Thanksgiving morning for what he has done. You'll get a snapshot of some of the music from the revival concert. And then on Sunday morning following, on the 29th, next Sunday, you're going to have an opportunity to witness the entire revival concert. And I'm telling you, I've been talking about it, bragging about it. I'm excited about this week. Look, love on your family, love on your friends, love on a neighbor, love on somebody. Let them know that you care about them, that you've been thinking about them. Don't leave people out there by themselves this week. I am, as I told you all many times before, I'm a grandmama's boy. I'm the oldest grandchild. I have that privilege. But I'm also a mama's boy. I'm the first child. I have that privilege too. Somebody called me spoiled, and I just told them, nope, I'm fortunate. I'm privileged. Amen. And so I talk to all of them. I talk to both of them usually multiple times a week. And then I get text messages from other family members. I want to give a shout out to my Aunt Louise this morning. And I got your text message late last night. I love you. I'm praying for you. And I'm thinking about you. I know that you're streaming and you're watching. And I want to give a shout out to everybody else in my family, my extended family, my community, my church family, my friends, all of you that take this time to spend time with me each and every week, and the National Baptist Memorial family. Look, I can't say it enough. I love each and every one of you, and there is nothing that you can do about it. And so until not even next week, just in a few days, midweek this week, I'll be here and be waiting for you and be looking for your participation. Remember, we are serious about our platform being adjusted and things moved around. And so if you are interested, like I said, in being a virtual usher, a virtual host, a virtual greeter, reach out. Let us know, because we're giving an opportunity right now for those of you that are so inspired to serve God, even from your kitchen or living room. Amen. Your kitchen or your living room, nowhere else. No cars, no bathrooms, none of that. Just kitchen or living room. Find somewhere that you would want to record something and send it in to us so that we can see you, we can hear from you, and we can know how you're doing in this season. So until Wednesday, let me announce this benediction to you, each and every one of you. God's grace upon you. God's mercy upon you. God's face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. Now unto him who is able to do exceedingly and abundantly above all that you, and even you could ever ask, think, or imagine, to the only wise God who was faithful, true, and just, be all dominion, majesty, glory, and power, henceforth, now, and forevermore. Go in peace. Until Thursday, go in peace. Go in peace. I'll see you soon.